Hello, I'm Tyne. Welcome to my channel. Today I am not on the floor, I am on a chair. So the approach today to not having a super dark background is I'm filming in front of the open window while it's still sunny outside, so hopefully this vibe is slightly more alive while I'm trying to figure out what sort of light I should get to light my background. But so, today I'm making a video that I thought I was gonna make a while ago, because it is currently the last day of August, and this video is a video that I thought I was gonna make in June, because it is from my capstone project. So if you happen to be here because of Minerva, if you know about Minerva, I wrote a capstone, which is like a thesis, and there are videos about it. I don't know, I'm not gonna explain the whole capstone. This is going to actually be sort of like a manifestation of that capstone, because today I want to talk about the topic of women in film, or more particularly, misogyny in films and feminism in films. What I really want to get at today is that the Bechdel test, which is sort of the most popular way that people identify films as having misogyny, is really outdated, that we could do with updating the Bechdel test to change the lens from does this film barely meet the minimum requirements to not be called misogynist. And I think we should shift our priorities because we've made a lot of progress actually, and we should be able to say, is this film actually feminist? So sort of like going from meeting a bare minimum to actually like helping gender justice as opposed to maybe just not hurting it. And so I want to explain, first of all, what the Bechdel test is in case you're not super familiar. Second, what I think the problems are with it. And for that, I'm going to go into a couple examples of films that maybe do pass the Bechdel test, but that we can still see problems with just from a general feminist standpoint. And then I'm going to give you some ideas maybe for things that you should be looking for in a truly feminist film. The hope is that this video will be the first of many, so that end part is going to be like the very beginning of a constructive conversation, but I don't want to just trash the Bechdel test and then like leave you hanging. So let's get into it. Tyne, what is the Bechdel test? Well, the Bechdel test is a set of three things, which if a film achieves these three things, it is said to, I actually don't know what they claim. It is said to treat women well. The actual like reason or conclusion of passing the Bechdel test is actually kind of ambiguous, which is why I say that it's just like, it's not misogynist, but there might be different interpretations or applications for using the test. The test is really just like a three thing, and it was adapted from a comic, I believe. Yeah, it was adapted from a comic, so it's not like it was super well thought out. It's more of like a popular culture type of thing. I know for me personally, I had heard of people using it as like a measure of whether they should support a film. So like if you're trying to decide if you should see something in theaters, if you want to give money to that production, some people want it to pass the Bechdel test. That's sort of the most common usage I've seen of it. But so, what are those three things? They are quite simply, one, does it have two women in the film, both of which have names? Two, do those two women talk to each other? And three, do they talk about something other than a man? That third one is the most open to interpretation a lot of the time, but there is a huge archive on the Bechdeltest.com that tells you the general consensus, I guess, of whether any movie, pretty much, they have a lot on there, passes this test. So let's talk about Sucker Punch. Sucker Punch is a Zack Snyder movie. It came out in 2011. It is about a female protagonist, and most of the supporting cast is also women. And the men, I hate to say this, there's like literally one man basically that's not kind of a bad guy. There's a couple maybe that are sort of more neutral, but like most of the men are bad guys. It seems like a pretty feminist movie. It also passes the Bechdel test because most of the cast is women. The girls talk to each other. They talk about breaking out of their asylum. If you haven't seen Sucker Punch, brief synopsis. Basically, there's this girl whose stepfather puts her into an asylum to get her under the table illegally lobotomized because he doesn't want her to be able to testify against him. I can't remember what exactly he did. He hurt her, killed her sister or something. But so she's in this asylum and she has 5 days to break out of the asylum. Otherwise, she's gonna get the lobotomy and become a potato, basically. It's kind of an equivalent of dying, you know? But the way the movie plays out is that she kind of... It's kind of ambiguous, but basically the movie actually takes place on 3 different levels of reality, and it's kind of portrayed as each deeper level is sort of her projecting or imagining a different scenario to help her not have to confront the difficulty of her true reality, which is being in an asylum. So the next level of sort of like unreality that we are introduced to is a like strip club situation where all of the girls are like dancers at a club, and the guy that's running the asylum is the guy that's running the club. It's all the same characters, but it's just the context changes, and it's sort of implied that this is what the main protagonist is experiencing. I interpret it as a coping mechanism. But so then the third layer of like unreality, so when she's already in the unreality of the dancing, she has action sequences that happen in this even more removed from reality, and the setting for those are always different, but the action sequences are like some sort of dangerous thing that she's trying to pull off. She has a full fight scene with like, it's very video gamey, like imaginary villains. There's one where there's like a train that they're trying to rob, all kinds of just like action scene nonsense to stand in for the idea of like stealing a knife or stealing a key. But so the girls are talking about all of their plans and everything, and even just like wanting to get out of the asylum, and they do have names. This is one that's actually kind of iffy to me, is that their names are pretty much all like nicknames, and the nicknames that we hear are pretty much all like stripper names, because they seem to only be given names on that second layer of reality. I don't know if we ever learn any of their like real names. So I'm kind of skeptical of whether it should really pass for them having names, because like Baby Doll and Sweet Pea, I don't know if that really counts as giving respect to them as women. But another thing that I have a big problem with is the costuming in the movie. The girls are hypersexualized all of the movie. I mean, in the strip club, obviously, but also in their action sequences, they have those kind of like slutty little outfits that are like not super realistic for fighting. And I would just generally say that in this film, you can tell that it is sort of enforcing us to look at the girls with a male gaze. I think I'm gonna do another video separate getting into what the male gaze is, but basically that the way that we're looking at them and the way that the movie is made to encourage us to look at them is objectifying. And because of that, I think that this is a good example of how the Bechdel test might not be good enough to really tell us if a film is feminist. There is a whole counter-argument to be made that it sexualizes them because the men within the movie sexualize them, and that it's supposed to spark that outrage and help us to understand their situation better. But I also think it's not truly feminist how men are so villainized in the movie, because feminism is supposed to be about equality of the genders. So I also have a problem with that. Basically, I think there's a lot of stuff in Sucker Punch that you could object to from a feminist standpoint, and for that reason, I hesitate to say that the Bechdel test is really doing its job as well as it could. I think this is a good point to also rewind and get into some historical context on the Bechdel test. So that comic strip that this test came from is actually from 1985. And I would say that it's hard to nail down when the Bechdel test became popular, but I think it's fair to say that it's been in usage for quite a while now. I think at least 20 years, because I'm guessing that it did spread a lot with the internet and people being able to reference these kind of sites to check if movies do pass it. And because of that, I think it is fair to say that it is somewhat outdated. Feminism has come a ways since 1985. Even if, you know, we haven't won all of the battles, things are still not great in a lot of ways. We are in a very different place than we were in 1985 as far as establishing equality of all genders. And I think that's why it's actually quite optimistic to say that we could do better than the Bechdel test, because you can also see over time, a lot of movies now do pass the Bechdel test, where in like the 60s, 70s, even 80s, a lot of them didn't. And because of that, I think it is fair to say that we should raise the standards. And it's no disrespect to the Bechdel test, it's more like it was a great development at the time, but we should keep pushing forward. So, in general, I think there's a couple main ways to think about whether a film is feminist. Well, maybe three. Honorable mention. One thing that gets talked about a lot is just having more women working in Hollywood in decision-making creative roles, and that just by having that diversity in the cast, it will translate to better representation on screen. That's one layer, but as far as looking at an actual movie that has been made, I don't think looking at who the cast is gonna tell you whether it's feminist. I know it seems unlikely, but a man could write and direct a feminist movie. And I think that there's sort of like too many assumptions built into that connection, because just because you're a woman doesn't mean that you don't have like internalized misogyny that you're going to let manifest in your creations. So the two layers I think you should really look at when you're looking at a film is both the content of the story. So like, who are the characters? What happens with the characters? And what does that seem to say about men and women? This is especially true with like looking at all of the women characters and all of the men characters and sort of seeing whether the development and growth and like strength in both of those groups is represented, or if one of them is super flat and doesn't see a lot of growth and is really two-dimensional basically. And the other thing is what I just talked about with Sucker Punch, more the look of the movie. I would almost say the mise-en-scene mixed with the cinematography, and sort of whether you see that perpetuation of a male gaze, of objectification, in the way it's shot and in the way the characters look, more so than like what they're saying and doing. I think those are kind of two separate issues. And so in the like what they're saying and doing realm, I think it's really important to know what to look for as far as a strong, developed character, because this is actually a trap that a lot of like feminist films fall into that ends up making them be labeled as bad movies. I think a lot of the like female lead action films have this problem, which is that the women characters that are supposed to be strong, supposed to be like badasses, don't have character growth. So they don't have a true, full, complete character arc. It's not really enough for a woman to be able to fight, to be able to kick ass. We also want to really empathize with them as a character and really give depth to them as a person by having them have some sort of internal struggle that results in growth and change in who they are throughout the plot. So there's a lot of different structures or ways of thinking about character growth and character arcs. One is the story circle. This is one I've been using a lot, so I'm gonna just use that one right now. But the story circle basically says that the arc of a character is that you have who they are at the beginning, you have sort of their status quo, but then they want something, and so they go into unfamiliar territory to pursue that thing, and they have to adapt to that new territory, and then they find that thing, but they have paid a price for it, and so when they return to a sort of stasis or normality, they have changed. So that's sort of internal conflict. Another thing I've heard a lot is that the external conflict in a movie should complement and enable the character's internal conflict to also be resolved. So an example of this is Laura Croft, I believe, in addition to being dressed very slutty, has been accused of being very, like, two-dimensional, because she, as a character, doesn't really have to change who she is, what she believes, or anything like that in order to get what she wants in all of the movies. And that sort of flatness to the character sort of takes away from our ability to empathize with and respect her as just a person, which just makes it harder for the movie to show how awesome women can be, and that these women are like real people, because person who fights crime but doesn't deal with any sort of internal conflict is just like so unrealistic that we don't transfer any sort of emotional connection with her into potentially our understanding of the world. I guess another topic for another video is whether movies even really affect our lives, because I think they do. And that's sort of a basis for even saying that films should be feminist. So there's yet another topic, hopefully I will get to. But so, looks, just appearance, is there a male gaze? And do the characters actually grow? Do they actually have three dimensions and an arc? And importantly, looking for balance between the cast of characters, seeing that sort of good representation for both the men and the women. Because it's important to remember that feminism isn't just about lifting up women, it is also not about stomping down men. We want both the genders to be respected. There is a whole other realm I like to get into with talking about gender portrayal in film, but it's a little more complex, so I think I might try to dabble in it, but it also might need its own dedicated video. And that is that I think films should try to break some norms for what a man is and what a woman is, because I think a lot of society's ideas about what's normal for a man and what's normal for a woman and sort of the expectations they bring to everybody in their life does come from what they're shown those genders mean and the responsibilities of those genders are in media. And for that reason, I am somewhat disappointed by films, by any sort of media that allows its most prominent women to fall into the box of like what is expected of a feminine woman without any sort of conflict or attempts to vary from the norm by any of their most prominent female characters. And the same goes for men. Like, we build such high expectations for masculinity, for men like not showing emotion and having to be sort of strong and not being able to have any of the sort of femininity. And that is also very harmful. So I really like, and I feel like a film is really doing good on the front of gender justice, if they're able to show a character that really flourishes, that really prospers, while doing some things that aren't strictly what society expects of a woman or a man, depending on what they are. So I think I might have to dive into that one a little bit more. That's kind of a basic explanation, but that is yet another way that we can be looking for films to do more, to be really feminist, to really be encouraging society to have greater gender justice. So I would really love if you could leave any questions, any responses below. This is really one of my first videos kind of trying to construct an argument like this while also explaining. And yeah, I'd love to hear anything you disagree with, anything you think I could have expanded on more. And I hope you'll subscribe to stick around and see more on this topic and other topics. I do all kinds of stuff. And like it if you liked it. And I'll see you next time.